this is a good thing. This is good. Trust me. Swear to God. This is fine. This is really, really a good thing, actually. Anywhere that you tell me to, if you need, you need me to be. Before Francisco Pizarro conquered the Incan Empire in 1533, the population, wealth, and influence of what is now Peru was concentrated in the fertile, easily defendable Andes Mountains. But once the Spanish took over, they needed a real capital city and a way to get Peru's wealth out from the coast back to Spain. As soon as they could, in 1535, Pizarro authorized Lima as the site for his new coastal capital, and the city has dominated Peru's economic, cultural, and political life ever since. The city stands as a testament to almost 500 years of regional dominance, and has grown century after century to anchor nearly a third of Peru's population, and become the third biggest city in Latin America today. But this doesn't mean that Lima's centuries of histories have been swept aside by rapid demands for growth and mass development. Lima's downtown is still filled with the city's iconic old yellow buildings with wooden covered balconies reaching out from their upper floors. Even in areas that are run down and at the end of too long of blocks for a good city center, these ornate dark wood balconies survive, peering over this pioneer city streets much the way they would have at the height of Spanish power. Instead of trying to bulldoze and rebuild their downtown to keep up with bigger and bigger populations over centuries of growth, Lima's instead focused on growing its urban footprint in as seamless and unobstructed way as possible. Downtown is flanked with major roads to bring people in, but they're reduced to the same crosswalks and sidewalks as any other city street as they cut in towards the city center, expanding the city seamlessly to Chinatown and the industrial centers to the west. In the south, we're met not by an expressway, but by a string of major squares and parks, pulling us along to a sort of a central park type strip, filled with museums and monuments. Only here do we hit a big expressway, but by now, the sheer attraction of these parks almost papers over it, letting the urban core continue uninterrupted into the neighborhoods below. The one major expressway continuing south is bolstered by the National Stadium and another major park for good measure, before small square blocks and neatly contrasting angles make an almost San Francisco-type layout out of Jesus Maria and San Isidro, until Lima's highest-income residents finally get a cliffside view of the Pacific Ocean. And using this coast, Lima spreads almost all the way up to the main port at Callao, with a pretty impressive consistency. This area largely has the winding streets and jigsaw patterns of suburban developments, and it's largely residential, but it's absolutely littered with small parks almost all the way up to the main industrial belt to the north. With two major universities anchoring the weird donut hole middle of this massive triangle of space, this style of development has filled an impressive amount of territory in a way that doesn't fully condemn them to residential suburban style living. All of these areas have urban style lots, and many have small, easily accessible blocks, and can be turned into popular neighborhoods and commercial hubs at any time with just a little rezoning. Put all this together, and the formal layout of Lima is a really good example of how you build out a city to become one of the largest in the Western Hemisphere. And for any normal city on a normal continent, this impressive amount of formal expansion would be more than enough to meet demand. But South America is no ordinary continent. See, Latin America as a whole is the most urbanized region in the world today, with 80% of its population living in urban areas. And due to Peru's history, Lima's been hit especially hard by this rush to the cities. With the large, high-density population of the old Incan Empire centered in the fertile lands by the Andes Mountains, and centuries of Spanish focus on mining operations far inland, Peru has a population that was 60% rural in the 1940s. But violent conflicts and growing rural poverty in the 20th century drove millions to find safety and employment in major industrial coastal cities. And Lima was sort of the only one. By the early 2000s, Peru was suddenly 73% urban. Lima's population ballooned from 500,000 to over 6 million, and a 1998 estimate counted 35% of Lima's residents living in informal, self-built slum housing. Thanks to these migratory pressures, informal housing is a massive problem plaguing almost every city in Latin America. Venezuela's barrios, Brazil's favelas, any plot of land not explicitly claimed yet by the formal city can quickly ossify into a high-density jumble of squatters, chaotically filling a demand for housing that no reasonable city can hope to keep up with. Operating outside laws and regulations and in a rush to provide shelter, these shanty towns leave no room for navigable roads, have no access to water or basic utilities and insulation, and require families to physically live on undeveloped land to claim a spot before enough building supplies can be acquired to build anything. And what might be worst of all is the illegal nature of these neighborhoods. Not only is there a constant fear of your entire neighborhood being demolished at any time, but the chaotic nature of these areas makes it all but impossible to enforce any ownership rights to your property. Unlike even the smallest time homeowners in the formal sector, residents of informal housing like this cannot sell their homes or businesses on the open market because the sale can't be backed up by any recognized law. Immediate rights to your home or business is often granted by informal groups, which can often be organized crime or heavily involved in bribing authorities, passing on their costs by exploiting the residents. You can't get a loan to expand your business or see any benefit from developing your house because these properties can't be used as collateral or for equity. Even the most entrepreneurial-minded residents will always be at a disadvantage compared to formally recognized businesses and residences if their community doesn't stifle their activities outright outside the purview of the law. If you're not careful, these informal developments can quickly add up to create a concentrated, disenfranchised underclass that's almost impossible to reintegrate with the formal economy. Though Lima might be one of the cities most susceptible to this proliferation of informal development, over the years it's adopted a number of different policies to encourage the organization and future development of its new urban migrant populations. An early example of working-class integration into a formally laid-out neighborhood was achieved in massive workers' housing developments in the La Victoria era in the 1930s. Cut off from the main urban corridor by major expressways, this expansion of the city was still laid out as a large, uninterrupted area of small blocks and parcels that was ripe to stand on its own the first chance it got. The growth of the textile industry that had been building here since the late 1800s gave the neighborhood of Gamara just the spark it needed to fill La Victoria's share of Lima's urban demand. From just a few factories to a major market street, Gamara now spreads for many blocks in all directions, filled with shop fronts and lined with carts and street vendors, comprising the largest informal textile market in South America. With uninterrupted pedestrian access from all of La Victoria's neighborhoods and direct rail access right alongside it, Gamara is the urban core of a city in its own right, complete with parks, shops, and amenities that would put many independent cities to shame. And because the lot sizes in La Victoria's blocks are so small, this neighborhood has been able to grow skyward and add more and more modern buildings at a lower cost, without disrupting the vibrant commercial activity taking place on the streets below. Offices and apartments in these high-rise developments increase the economic and residential density of the city, without resorting to the commerce-stifling New York housing project style of low-income housing that Lima could have envisioned for La Victoria. Even in this neighborhood, originally built as part of the formal city, Lima has left the meeting of the city's needs to the people who have to live in it. But what really sets Lima apart is its approach to the building of the shantytowns themselves. As the third biggest city in the Western Hemisphere, Lima always knew it was going to have squatters and informal housing built on its outskirts no matter what it did. So in 1971, when another wave of rural migrants descended upon the city, Lima resettled 4,000 families to the Tablada de Lurin at the southern end of the city. Without the resources to build housing or utilities, Lima surveyed the land, laid out parcels for development, and offered the property rights to any Lima squatter that would build something on it. It was, in practice, a shantytown. There was no running water, no amenities. You took a plot of land and acquired building materials until you had little more than a roof over your head. But instead of living in the shadows outside the law, the layout and governance of this informal city was carefully coordinated between the government and local groups. What resulted was not an impenetrable mess of building code violations and inaccessible shacks, but the remarkably vibrant, well-designed city of Villa El Salvador. Not only did this result in a layout that made it easy to add basic utilities within the first few years of the project, but the design of the various sectors themselves made for a near seamlessly interconnected city. I mean, just look at these blocks. Everyone is small and easily traversable, and the roads actually link up with the corresponding roads in the sector next to them. And you can't go four blocks before you hit a community-centering park square that you can see straight down to by looking down almost any street you pass. What makes this all tie together is Lima's vision of Villa El Salvador not as a housing development, but as an independent city development. There's no restriction on building use in any of these land parcels, meaning the entire city is a mixed-use neighborhood. Shops and restaurants are allowed to pop up spontaneously at convenient intersections in the areas most trafficked by pedestrians and residents. This allows every neighborhood here to develop differently, with capitalist accountability and a focus on the needs of your immediate community. These may be some of the poorest residents in the Lima area, but they're not shackled by the indignity of a monopoly supplier for their essentials and indulgences. And because it's possible to keep track of every resident, supplementary assistance such as Peru's Vaso de Leche program to give milk to poor children is easy to implement, and it makes it easier to cut down on exploitation of the residents out of desperation. The only bad part of Villa El Salvador's design is these periodic large road medians cutting apart the different sections. I mean, look, I'm all for more parks, and especially for more parks that you can access from as many areas as possible. But these road medians' attempts at park development only succeed for very short stretches at a time in very specific areas. In most places, these one-block-wide medians form a hot, arid barrier that restricts the different neighborhoods to their own sectors, no matter how vibrant or popular they become. I mean, look at the places around here. You can't even see what's on the other side of the street. And meanwhile, car traffic is treating these broad, multi-lane roads as their own territory, with few formal pedestrian crossings. See, the benefit of parks and cities is to have a place for nearby residents to easily access from all directions. With these roads, you can't help but feel like you're leaping out of the trenches to charge enemy lines every time you try to cross the street. This style of park median is very reminiscent of the Christie Forsyth Park down in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. Just like the road medians here, the blocks in between Christie and Forsyth streets were emptied out and heavily manicured as park grounds with basketball courts, playgrounds, rest areas, and anything the city thought its residents would want. In practice, what it actually gave them was a street that's a major hassle just to cross, especially where brick walls and iron fences prevent New Yorkers' favorite pastime of jaywalking in the middle of blocks. It's difficult to see even what's going on in the park itself behind these walls and trees, and the street on the other side might as well not exist for all your ability to get to it. As a result, these streets are lined with restaurant supply depots, warehouses, and back ends of buildings, not to mention a fair bit of graffiti and unpleasant odors. Instead of building a wall to keep people apart, Manhattan's Lower East Side largely rectified this mistake with the road median for Allen Street two blocks down. It's got all the amenities that Villa El Salvador's put into its road medians, a pedestrian path, benches, trees, and even two integrated bike lanes, but all in a much slimmer profile. Allen Street's median is slim and approachable from every direction, and the buildings on the other side of the road are so close it's almost like you just have to cross the street and you're there. Because of this, both sides of Allen Street have a lot more trendy restaurants and retail storefronts and are rapidly being drawn into the gentrified core of this new, hot Manhattan neighborhood. If any of Villa El Salvador's neighborhoods find themselves with this kind of success, a narrower road median park would let that success expand and grow to surrounding areas, instead of meeting it with an unattractive, inaccessible dead end. But beside the road medians, the rest of Villa El Salvador is a near-perfect city layout that any city dweller would want to live in. And thanks to Peru's government policies, the city's residents are both building that city into existence and standing to benefit from its improvement. You see, back in the 80s, Peru was facing a massive communist insurgency from the Shining Path guerrilla army, feeding off of disenfranchisement to the poor in a country where most land was in large colonial parcels owned by the elite. The Shining Path was beginning to encroach upon Lima's shantytown, seeking both fear and support against an official government more and more unable to give them jobs or sustenance. In the face of this challenge, Peruvian economist Hernando de Soto developed an intensive new approach to land reform, which he laid out as the other path in 1986. De Soto proposed to formalize individual ownership of the farms and city homes to the poor that occupied them, and to rewrite Peruvian law to match the property rights being practiced on the ground in these communities. What resulted was the ability for these poor residents to suddenly build home equity and credit based on the homes they themselves had built. De Soto saw America's entrepreneurial growth as built out of the accountability and collateral that formal individual property ownership gave to its inventive citizens. And in Villa El Salvador, we can already see all but the newest of these sections showing that same inventive spirit. Multiple stories in buildings and storefronts are common, and buildings made of modern building materials and construction techniques are more and more common in the old center of the city, now that the squatters no longer have to personally defend their land parcels during construction. Houses in Villa El Salvador are being sold in the formal housing market, and the ability to sell your house or commercial storefront has meant that home improvement costs can be recouped in mortgages or sale prices, and loans secured to finance them. What used to be this now looks more and more like this, all thanks to citizens' access to formal financial infrastructure and the property required to make it work for them. Before long, the inherent value of these blocks as urban territory will allow them to develop to the same degree as similarly laid out Argentinian cities like Mendoza and San Rafael. Here we can see the same small parcel sizes in very similar urban parks, but the apartments around them have more modern high-rise offerings and anchor trendy commercial districts nearby. There's no reason that Villa El Salvador shouldn't match the success of these modern planned cities, because it was planned, just like these cities. It's just that the developers were a lot poorer, but the planners never thought they should stay that way. That's the secret to Lima's growth. In any other part of the world, Lima's formal city expansion would be considered spectacular. But as Peru's only major coastal city, it was never going to be able to keep up with Latin America's rapid urbanization in the 20th century. Instead of following conventional regulations and requirements within its formal city limits and letting informal slums grow haphazardly around it, Lima focused on making sure the layout of the city as a whole was practical and that its citizens had the resources they needed to develop the city into a unified whole. The sprawling markets of Gamara and the new city of Villa El Salvador show that a good city layout and resident participation in the success of their neighborhoods fosters development and growth beyond the wildest dreams of the formal planners. Good planning also makes formal ownership easier to enforce for local residents, further spurring the enfranchisement of the local population and the development of far-flung neighborhoods. As a result of Lima's approach, an already massive city has turned into an urban conglomerate of unprecedented proportions, ready to spread its economic growth across a full third of Peru's population. And with the right planning and institutions in place, the next great episode of Lima's 500-year history of growth might just be built by its own residents' hands. Hey, yeah, Parcel!
Gardens, they can ease the mind and be seen from the road. The layout's beauty goes beyond its barriers and makes it easy to grow. One sidewalk on the shoulder, blocks I can walk with my feet.
Draw you right over.
Parks that'll draw you right over. That's alluded before. Local walk on the shoulder. Box I can walk with my feet. Parks that draw you right over. El Salvador. Blocks I can walk with my feet. Parks that'll draw you right over. El Salvador is sweet.
Maybe
one side walk on the side, walk on the shoulder.
But what do you guys think? Is Lima doing a good job? What would you like to see Lima do to improve their city? Let me know in the comments below. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up on your way out. And if you want to see more videos like this, just hit the subscribe button. We should have one out every 2 weeks, and you won't want to miss it. Anyway, I'm Mike, and I just looked at the map.